Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Stellar Shows at JAX. This presentation of Eclectic American Roots is a showcase for the music and lifestyle that celebrates the origins and legacy of authentic American music. Please give generously early and often as we present this new series. The proceeds go to connecting you with the Eclectic American Roots musicians that you love and encourages them with support through these challenging and uncertain times. I've been privileged for many years to be able to present the best in live roots music through Stellar Shows. Throughout the weeks to come, Stellar Shows remains committed to curating live talent, even with our clubs and venues shutting down, and all our performers being trapped in their homes. Roots music is all about taking entertainment back to a time when the words and the songs were much more meaningful compared to the overproduced music of today. And thanks to JAX Entertainment, Stellar Shows at JAX presents Eclectic American Roots. Welcome to Eclectic American Roots, our cure for the coronavirus. You know, when you talk about American roots music, the blues is one of its cornerstones. And the mouth harp is a key element of the worldwide blues scene. Playing blues harmonica is a sorcerer's art. It takes a little attitude, a little improvisation, and a dash of mumbo jumbo. Nicknames for the harmonica include the Mississippi saxophone, the wheeze box, the hobo harp, harpoon, and the tin sandwich. Harmonicas have been around since Germany shipped them to America by the millions in the 1800s, along with millions of German immigrants. It didn't take long for sharecroppers in the South to adopt the harp to their own style of the blues, making it one of the coolest instruments ever. And let's face it, if anyone was saddled with the blues, it was those hard-working sharecroppers. The blues usually refers to melancholy and sadness, and it's constantly heard in lyrics to describe a depressed mood. But blues is a form of expression, a feeling that evokes both suffering and joy. And the reason most folks turned to the harmonica for solace and entertainment back then, it was the fact that it was so cheap. 10 cents was the going price for a German-made harp in the 1800s. The American Civil War, with everyone away from their homes, made the harmonica very popular all over America. As blues music evolved, more and more white musicians started recognizing the mouth harp's potential, which has made it one of the most popular instruments of the 19th century. The rise of amplified blues harmonica in the late 1940s created a highly concentrated sound that was loud enough to project over the noise on street corners and nightclubs. The harmonica has been popular across many genres, folk, country, rock, jazz, and even classical music, as well as the blues. And now, Eclectic American Roots is going to show you the roots of blues harmonica. Like Muddy Waters puts it, when you've got no bread and you're lovesick, then you've got the blues. Our co-host today has been in the SoCal blues scene since 1989. Scott Abeyta of Ripcat Records. Scott has performed with John Clifton for many years and also shared the stage with Rod Piazza, Rick Estrin, James Harman, Dennis Greenling, Kid Ramos, Junior Watson, Alex Schultz, and so many others. He's played in all the COVID countries, Korea, France, Germany, Switzerland, Denmark, the Netherlands, and Poland, as well as over 30 states here in the US. In 2010, Scott started Ripcat Records, a SoCal-based blues and Americana record label featuring albums by The Blasters, Rod Piazza, Kid Ramos, Alistair Green, and John Clifton, just to name a few. Scott started Ripcat Records as a way for his friends to make and distribute their own albums. The first band to put Ripcat on the map was the 44s, whose first two blues albums had great success. Ripcat also garnered a BMA nomination for their first release, the mighty Mojo Prophets. Having created a label by the artist, for the artist, Ripcat was able to capture the attention of Phil Alvin and John Baz from the Blasters. In 2012, they released Fun on Saturday Night. Since then, Ripcat has released 38 albums by Southern California's finest blues bands, as well as bands from Cleveland, Las Vegas, New Orleans, Phoenix, Fresno, Bakersfield, and Poland. Please welcome to our broadcast today, Scott Abeyta.
Hey, Christopher, thank you for having me. It's great to be part of your show at Stellar Shows at JAX. I really appreciate it. It's really an honor. Thank you.
Blues guitar ace Kid Ramos got the blues early in life, like when he was 14. Kid Ramos joined harmonica expert James Harman's blues band in 1980, playing up and down California alongside bands like X, Oingo Boingo, The Blasters, and The Plimsolls. From 1980 to 1988, Kid played with the Harman Band, after which he had a brief stint with Room Full of Blues. From 93 to 2002, he was a member of the Fabulous Thunderbirds. Currently, he's playing with the Proven Ones. After a bout of cancer in 2012, the music community came together and helped Kid survive the worst years of his life. Kid has also worked with the Big Rhythm Combo, the Manish Boys, Bobby Jones, and Los Fabulocos over his impressive career. Kid has also played with just about every blues harpist on today's program. I'm proud to welcome as one of our hosts today, one of my friends and guitar heroes, Kid Ramos.
Hey, kid, it's good to see you. How are you holding up?
I'm holding up fine. How you doing up there in Fresno?
Doing all right. It hasn't got too hot up here yet.
It's hot down here.
Yeah, right on. So, kid, one of the reasons I was really interested in having you as a co-host is because I know that you played with everybody on the show. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Pretty much every single one of them. Yeah, every one of them. I started with James Harman and was in James' band for 7 years. And during that time, I met Al Blake, of course, Hollywood Fats was in the band with me, and he has a history with Al. So Al would come to see us play and sit in with us, and got to meet Al and play with Al on many occasions. And also William Clark used to come see us play and sit in. So those guys were great guys and great harmonica players, obviously. At that time also, Rod Piazza, I filled in for Junior Watson on a few occasions when he was sick. And played with Rod and his band. And of course, I was in the Fabulous Thunderbirds for 7 years and played with Kim Wilson. And during that time, I made a solo CD that had Charlie Musselwhite on it and Rick Estrin from the Nightcats and also Paul DeLay, who's passed away. And so I've got to play with a lot of these guys. So this is a music show, not a talk show. So at this moment, we will segue right into Kim Wilson. She's tough.
You ought to see my baby when she walked down the street. Upset everybody she meet. She 23 on the waist, 38 in the hip. She got long black wavy hair and ruby red lips. She is tough. Oh, she tough. My baby's tough. She rough and tough. And that's tough enough. Well, she walked past the clock. The clock won't tell time. She walked through the college. Professor losing mind. But she tough. Oh, she tough. My baby's tough. She rough and tough. And that's tough enough. Let's go, Gino.
Yeah.
Hey, Kid, you played with them for a long time. Do you have any cool stories?
I do. I have a great story. When I was 18 years old, I had a good buddy I grew up with that had moved back to Arlington, Virginia, and he sent me a plane ticket when I graduated from high school, and he said, I'm moving back to California. I graduated from Virginia. I came out there one night. I said, let's go see some live music, because he lived right near Georgetown. And we were looking for this jazz club to see the great bebop sax player, Sonny Stitt. Never could find this club. And Georgetown is a very busy place. But he goes, let's go to the Bayou and see who's playing at the Bayou. And a club right there in Georgetown. We went up there and said, appearing tonight, the Fabulous Thunderbirds. Never heard of them. This is 1978, I think. 77, summer of 77, going into 78, something like that. We walked in this little club and the Fabulous Thunderbirds were playing. Blew my mind completely. Jimmy Vaughn, Keith Ferguson, Mike Buck, and Kim Wilson. And they played three sets, and we stayed the whole time, and I was just completely blown away. Went up and talked to them on the break. Of course, they just looked at me like I was some stupid kid, which I was. And years later, I ended up being in that band.
That's awesome.
Hey, Scott, who's our first guest tonight?
Oh, now we have Al Blake from the Hollywood Fats Band. But first, we're going to hear a song from Willie Dixon, who was a big influence on him.
Baby, I declare you're so divine.
welcome to the show. Al Blake. Al, it's good to see you again. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Yourself?
Great, great. I know we're all hunkered down, and you're out there in Newport Beach. How's the weather down there today?
It's beautiful. It's beautiful, and I'm working. I'm not hunkered down. I'm working.
Oh, good for you. We have Kid Ramos here with us. Say hey to Kid.
It's good to be working. It's good to be healthy, and it's good to be outside as much as we can.
So, Al, you were the front man for the Hollywood Fats Band. Can you tell us a little bit about that, how that came to be, and maybe some stories about playing in that band?
Sure. I met Hollywood Fats through Freddie King, who I knew previously to that. I grew up in Oklahoma, and in my senior year in high school, I met Freddie King a couple of times. He came to California in the 60s, and I went to the Ash Grove to see him perform. And I went up to the dressing room at the Ash Grove, and he said, "Al, have you ever heard of a kid named Hollywood Fats?" I said, "I've never heard of him." He said, "I want you to meet this kid. He's the most fabulous young guitar player." And I didn't really take what he said seriously, but long story short, Fats and I became very good friends. We started playing together when he toured with, starting with J.B. Hutto, then on to John Lee Hooker, then Albert King, then Muddy Waters, and Witherspoon for about a 5-year period. He left the road. We decided to put a band together. We played together for 5-6 years as the Fats Band.
And now, Al, we'd like you to play a song for us. What do you got?
I'd like to start out by dedicating this song titled Bye Bye Bird to all the victims of the pandemic around the world. My thoughts go out to you this morning. Bye-bye, bird. So long, little bird. Pretty little bird, I'm gone. Now one of these mornings, and it won't be long, you might call my name, but I'll be gone. To my new heavenly home. Bye-bye, bird. So long, little bird. Bye-bye, bird. So long, pretty bird. Pretty little bird, I'm gone. Thank you.
take the good with the bad. Baby, come what may, I'll meet you on the other side of some sweet day. That's what the good book say. Bye-bye, brave. So long, little brave. Bye-bye, brave. So long, pretty brave. Pretty little bird, I'm gone.
So, Al, in 2019, you had Best Album of the Year. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, it came as a shock to me, but I'm thrilled. Let me put it this way. Over the years, we'd go into the studio and record, and I would always try to save a little time to record some of me playing guitar with Fred Kaplan or by myself. And I saved those recordings for years, but I never. And some years ago, I met with the owner of, or the CEO of Top Cat Records in Dallas, Texas. He said, "Al, you've got to release those recordings. They're amazing." So eventually, 2019, we got it together, put up two double C 728 tracks. These recordings are all basically solo. They're either solo, duets, and a couple of trios. Mostly me playing guitar, not harmonica. There's five or six tracks with me playing harmonica. But the collection also features Kim Wilson, which features Freddie Kaplan on piano. And I'm very proud of those recordings. I probably should have released them earlier, but better late than never. I'm 75 now. I'm just getting recognized for that aspect of my blues playing.
Slow down, slow down. Please let me step on board. I just wanna ride this train one time before you go. You bought the sweetest little girl that I have ever seen. If I had you by my side, it would mean so much to me. Searching, I've been looking for mighty near all of my life, and no matter where I go, can't never feel satisfied. So slow down, slow down. Please let me step on board. I just wanna ride this train one time before you go.
We're about to put up some information on the virtual tip jar. This is your opportunity to support the artist on the show and help out. You know, we're having a rough time. Everybody's having a rough time with this virus, and your support is really helpful. And also check out stellarJAX.com, and that's J-A-X, stellarJAX.com. Thank you. So, kid, you know, back in the days, I kept hearing about this James Harman band. And I finally got to see you guys in Hollywood. What was that place called? The Ford Theater, outdoor theater. And you were on the group.
Yeah.
And it just completely blew my mind. That was it for me. I knew that I wanted to play blues guitar after seeing you guys. And I knew that I wanted to back harmonica players. That was such a huge influence on me. The other influence on me with James Harman was the day I got home from Lamar's Records with Extra Napkins. And I put that on, and I put the needle on there, and the first song came on. And to this day, that's the kind of music that I want to put on Ripcat Records. And that was you too.
Well, I spent 7 years of my life in James Harman band, so to keep it short, it's really difficult because I got a lot of stories, and they go forever, man, you know? But I'll never forget the first night I saw them play, and a friend brought me down to see them play, and I came in, and they're wearing these, you know, shark skin suits and greased up hair, and they're playing blues, man. And that was it for me. I go, I got to get in this band. And I ended up being in that band. So, you know, James Harman really changed my life, man. He introduced me to a lot of different kind of music. We used to have parties at his house and listen to records. He would barbecue and we'd drink cold beer and just listen to records all night, man. Me and Willie J. Campbell and James Harman would just sit in his record room, and we'd be the everybody else would leave by that time, and it would just be the hardcore people. And we'd be in there listening to those records, and James would be the DJ, spinning records, man. It was one of the greatest times of my life. I'll never forget. Very cool.
We have James Harman coming up next.
Hey, Scott. Yes, James. Look here, man. I appreciate your story about coming to see the band and then buying Extra Napkins, and glad it got to you, because that was the plan from the very beginning, was to upset people and make them pay attention, because, you know, the blues was in a fairly low point at that moment. But, you know, we all have our low moment. This other night I was telling this lady, you know, I'm old now. I'm not as good as I once was, but I'm as good once as I ever was. I just wrote this song. Check it out. Go ahead, Nathan. Look here. You know, bad taste will dissipate. Nightmares end when you away. But living with pain, mighty, mighty hard to take. Cause, darling, darling, anger never takes a break. You get back home after a long, long ride. The sharpest pain will finally subside. Anger's the biggest thorn you'll ever have in your side. Cause anger, baby, won't let up till somebody's died. Anger lives in a man's emotion. Yes, it does, and a dying love provides all the motion. It all comes clear, and it wipes the slate. Cause anger, darling, never takes a break. Take me to the bridge, Nathan. Look here. I said pain is a given. It never goes away. It'll run you ragged. My, 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 every single day. Pain is the first lesson that you'll ever learn, and the last thing you'll feel when your body starts to burn. I said pain don't rest by anybody's plan. It it worries all the women just like it worries all the men. Pulls you apart just because it can. And pain kills you all when the stuff hits the fan. Look here. Never takes a break, Nathan.
Wow, there's so many great blues harmonica players out there, and there's no way for us to get them all into one show. So we're going to watch a really great clip that has a bunch of different guys in it. Let's roll.
Thank you.
Speaking of Ripcat Records, this Friday we have a new release coming out by Orphan John and the Abandoned called Reckless No More. It'll be in stores and online, available Friday. Also, we have are going to put the tip jar information back up again for you. This is, again, your opportunity to help out the artists on the show and support live music in this really tough time for us. And do check out stellarJAX.com, J-A-X. Thank you. Grammy nominee, Blues Award winner, author, Heartman Mark Hummel had a banner year in 2014. Grammy nominated for his Remembering Little Walter CD. He produced and performed on. Mark also won Best Blues CD and Best Traditional Blues CD at the Blues Music Awards in Memphis. Mark's The Hustle Is Really On climbed to number 2 and stayed in the top 5 for 4 months on the Living Blues chart. Hummel's book, The Big Road Blues, 12 Bars on the I-80, garnered rave reviews and was nominated for Best Independent Book Release.
He's a Grammy-nominated Blues Award winner, author, heart man. You know, he's all that and more. And Mark and I go way back, played with a lot of the same bandmates through the years. And me, Mark Hummel, glad to have him here tonight with us. I remember seeing James Cotton back in the 70s, you know, at the Golden Bear.
First three people I saw were... on three different shows. I saw Brownie McGee and Sonny Terry, and then I saw, I think, yeah, James Cotton right after that, and then I saw Charlie Musselwhite not long after that. But yeah, Cotton was really a big influence on me because he was really the first electric harp player I saw, and it was probably about a year after that video that we were just showing.
I saw that same band.
Did you see those guys?
I saw that same band in the 70s. Yeah.
At the Golden Bear,
because that was in my neighborhood. So
right.
I saw everybody there, Muddy Waters and,
right,
you know, Albert King and BB and Freddie King. And I got to see all those guys, Buddy Guy and Junior Wells together. And
Yeah.
And that was Mecca for me, you know, and I saw Cotton at that period of time too. I think I might have seen him with Muddy one time too.
Did you?
Seems to me I did.
I saw Muddy at the Whiskey Go-Go the first time I saw him. It was a double bill.
I saw him at the Whiskey as well.
It was Muddy and Jimmy Rogers opened for him.
Oh, wow, man.
I bet that was something.
I never got to see Jimmy, man.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Yeah, those days are all gone, man.
They sure
all those guys are gone.
Every one of them cats is gone, man. It's very strange.
It's amazing. Yeah, there's no replacing those guys.
That's right. You know, it's funny because I didn't get to see a lot of those guys in my time. And for me, I watched like you, Mark, and Rod Piazza and James Harman. You guys were my dad growing up and learning to play. You guys were my connection to it. I did get to spend a little time with Otis Rush. But other than that, it was, you know, and I saw Albert Collins and Albert King and a few of the guys, but not like you guys. I never got to see Muddy Waters. I never got to see a lot of those guys. So I'm envious, but I want you to know that you were my influence in that.
That's nice to know. Yeah. Appreciate that.
Yeah. I remember when I was the age that you guys were talking about, living in Long Beach going to school, you would come into town and play those shows for Dan Jacobson. And that was a big, yeah.
Yeah.
And it was a big event for us, you know, we would go and see it and it was like, wow, Mark Hummel.
I played on those a few times. I did a lot of shows for Dan.
At the Golden Sales?
Right.
Yeah. And at Bogart's, did you play down there too?
I think so. Yeah, I actually played. I remember playing. I have a picture of when I had James Cotton. I had James Cotton on a number of the harmonica blowouts. And I have a photo, actually, of James in front of the Blue Cafe with my parents.
Oh, wow, cool.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. All right, Mark, you got a harmonica with you?
Yeah, what did I do, something fast or slow? You know what? I'm going to do like one. This is a... Sonny Boy One. John Lee Williamson was a...
John Lee Williamson?
Yeah, he was a really big influence on guys like Lil Walter and Junior Wells and James Cotton. A lot of the Chicago guys were really influenced by him because he was really the guy that... the best way to put it was that he was kind of the granddaddy of all the Chicago blues harmonica players. There really wouldn't have been a Lil Walter without... John Lee Williamson, and guys like Billy Boy Arnold were very influenced by him. So I'm gonna do one of his tunes here. Let's see if this harp holds up because it's literally missing the the screws on it.
The screw on the bottom.
Let's see if I can get through this on this harp. All right. So this one called "Shake Your Boogie" that John Lee Williamson did. When the baby went straight out all night long, didn't come home until the break of dawn. Come on, shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie, because your boogie's all right with me. Come on, give me a dog, I'm on a wire his nose. I'll even heard a man about my jelly roll. Come on, and shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie, because your boogie's all right with me. Yeah. When I tell me, mama, what you trying to do? You trying to love me and some other man too? Come on and shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie. Come on, shake your boogie, because your boogie's all right with me.
Yeah, man.
Awesome. Great.
That's one of John Lee's tunes. Yeah, I know you guys are doing this about Lil Walter, and Lil Walter was really my, I mean, out of all the harp players I started listening to when I was a teenager, Lil Walter was the one that really caught my attention. One of the reasons I picked the James Cotton number was because it was James Cotton doing Off the Wall by Lil Walter. And when I first saw James Cotton play at the Ashgrove back, you know, when I was like 16 or something, what knocked me out was he was playing only for about maybe 10 or 20 people on a Monday night at the Ashgrove, and he still threw himself just completely into his performance. It wasn't like he didn't have to have any kind of sold out crowd to really, you know, put on just a hell of a show. And he did a ton of Lil Walter that night, I remember, you know, and it was just, it was a thrill to get to hear one of the older cats. You know, the weird thing is now I look back and I go, he wasn't older. He was probably 30 years younger than me at the time, but you know.
No, I mean, we could go on and on about Lil Walter and James Cotton and everything. And of course, you know, if you're a harmonica player and you don't know anything about Lil Walter, then what can you say?
Look for another vocation.
Lil Walter.
You don't know anything about
him. Exactly. Lil Walter was, he was the, you know, if you talk to Kim Wilson, he's going to say Lil Walter.
That's right.
You know, you talk to these guys, and everybody has their, you know, Sonny Boy, son John Lee Williamson or Sonny Boy Williamson, you know, Rice Miller. You know, there's, everybody has their favorites. I'd say probably Rick Estrin leans more towards Sonny Boy, you know, and everybody. But Lil Walter still is the, that's the guy, man.
Well, he was the guy that kind of changed the whole landscape on everything. I mean, I got to admit, I don't, you know, it's not like I couldn't really live in a world where there was just one guy. I have to hear all the time.
I agree.
As a guitar player, Little Walter was a huge influence on me because of the people that he played with. And coming up in that area, Southern California, with you guys, the music that we played was backing harmonica players, so we had to know that Little Walter stuff, you know. Mark, you have a video picked out for us. Could you introduce it?
Yeah, this is a video of the band that I had from 2012 to 2016. Little Charlie just passed away, and this was the band Little Charlie was in, and we still have the band with Anson and Wes Starr on drums and R.W. Grigsby on bass. But now, like, Rusty Zinn's going to be doing some gigs with us later in the year. That's kind of what we got going. Cool. But this is a clip of us from, I think, 2015 or 16, of us doing a T-Bone Walker. This is one I know you used to do.
Bye. in the morning, baby, you know I got to go. Leaving in the morning, baby, you know I got to go. So you know, love, now I can't stay here no more.
Next, we've got something really special for you. Jackie Sackheim has been taking photos of blues legends for years, and she has a great new book coming out next year, and she's allowing us to take a special peek preview at some of the great photos. Is John Clifton, whose band I've played in since 2015. And in fact, I moved to Fresno just to be in his band. So let's bring him on. Come on, John. Hey, John, why don't you tell us about this first video you picked?
Okay. Well, this first video, I'm not so sure that it's my biggest inspiration of a harmonica player performance, but it's absolutely inspirational. And it's one of my favorite videos on YouTube. It's Good Rockin' Charles with the Aces, who were Little Walter's backup band. And this is probably from the early 70s sometime. And Good Rockin' Charles was kind of a lesser known Chicago blues player. He's a sideman. He played with a lot of people like Arthur Big Boy Spryers and, you know, guys, Smokey Smothers. And he's he only made one album. And it's just his whole approach, his whole stage presence and everything. It's just the blues. It's just, it's a classic example of, you know, everything being done right, you know, and it's fantastic.
Well, I'm going down the road. I'll be Fannie Mae. I'm gonna tell a family hood. Boyfriend saying I don't start minute talking. I'll tell everything I know. I'm gonna bring up all this in the fine, 'cause somebody's got to go. Jackie Ware, 2 hours around town, and get some market. Gets out on the street, old George stopped. He knocked her down, he black in the eye. She come back home, tell her I'm alive. I don't start minute talking, I tell everything I know. I'm gonna break up all this in the fine, 'cause somebody's got to go. Oh, one. What a beauty shot. He honked at home. She began to stop. Said, take me, baby, around the block. I'm calling the beauty shop. Why? Get my hair started. Start meaning talking. I'll tell everything I know. I'm gonna pick up all this thing to find. Cause somebody's got to go. Oh, yeah! Some money for the beauty shop. He honked at home. She began to stop. Said, take me, baby, around the block. On the beauty shop, why? Get my house done. Start really talking. I'll tell everything I know. I'm gonna bring up all the things to find. Oh, somebody got to go.
So, John, I know that you played a long time in the scene before I was in the band. You started right around the same time I did in the early 90s, late 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about some of the people that you played with and some of the influences that you've had over the years.
Well, I played, you know, like, there was a, I played a lot with Luther Tucker, of course, you know. I did dozens of gigs with him. He would come to Fresno and we'd back him up. And me and my brother... and a little band that we had then. And funny thing is the first time he came over and we rehearsed, and we were absolutely just horrible, and everybody was just in awe of him because he was such a good, I mean, nobody played guitar like him, nobody, you know. And we were just, everything was tight, we were all messed up, and nothing was comfortable. And we got done with the rehearsal and all with our heads hanging down. And he goes, don't worry about it. We get to the gig, it'll be show and tell. And so, okay, well, let's see what happens. And then he goes, okay, we got to get a few things straight here. Who's bringing a bottle? And my brother said, a bottle, what do you want? He said, how about some whiskey? And I said, okay, well, we'll get some whiskey. And he goes, okay, next rule is you don't tell my girlfriend we got it. And then, okay, well, that's cool. We could do that. Then he goes, does anybody smoke in the band? And, of course, back then we were all smoking cigarettes. And my brother says, yeah, we all got cigarettes, man. He goes, oh, great. Okay. And he takes a pause for a minute, kind of shakes his head. And then he says, I mean the salted kind. And, oh, weed. Yeah, we get some weed, you know. Sure, you know. And so when we got over there, we played, drank whiskey, smoked weed, smoked cigarettes all night long, and had a good time, you know. And we played it. Quite a few gigs together like that, you know, with him, and it was fun, man. It was great. And he was a guy that played with Little Walter and Sonny Boy Williamson, so he, you know, you'd start blowing the harp and it was just, he's playing all this shit that you heard on the records, just like the records, because he was the guy on the records, you know. It's amazing. That was my first encounter with somebody like that, you know. This was back in the, about probably 1991, something like that, 1990 maybe.
So who was the first guy who got you into playing harmonica? What made you want to play harmonica?
I heard, I'm not ashamed of this, I heard Whammer Jammer. And I heard Whammer Jammer by J. Geil's band Magic Dick. And to me, that just blew my mind. I mean, I have to do that, you know? And so I started buying those records and listening to that. And a lot of that turned into, you know, other things. You know, I around the same time I heard Muscle White, and I got Charlie Musselwhite records, and that was a little different than what you know, Jay Giles was doing. That got me a little more into the blues. That's why I discovered Little Walter. I started reading the back of the album covers, and I seen, oh, Walter Jacobs, who's that? Okay, I read up, found out it's Little Walter. Then I bought some Little Walter, and all of that stuff started snowballing from there. But Magic Dick, and I had a chance to, first time I met Magic Dick, you know, I told him I was a fan, and he said, yeah, right, the first three albums, right, which are the three bluesiest albums. And I go, yeah, and I also like, you know, I started going through their whole catalog, you know, and he stopped, he looked, he goes, all right. We ended up talking, like, for about 2 hours about all kinds of shit, like the harmonica cats and, you know, all this crazy stuff that, you know, he likes and we both like, you know, a bunch of stuff in common. And every time I see him, it sounds like we start talking about the harmonica cats, you know, because that's his, Jerry Mirard is his guy, you know. And that's cool, man, you know.
All right. So you're going to play something for us?
Sure. What song do you want to hear? I'll just play some blues for you, okay? The next video is I'm on stage with a bunch of cool guys, Billy Boy Arnold and myself, Mark Hummel, Billy Flynn, Sugar Ray Norcia, Charlie Musselwhite, Curtis Salgado, and Little Charlie Beatty. And it's a harmonica show. And Billy Boy Arnold does the first solo, and I do the second solo. And it's cool solo, you know. I did a little syncopation there, and everybody dug it. So, but I'm pretty proud of that one because, you know, there's a bunch of heavy hitters up there.
If it's Saturday night, you need to go to facebook.com/West Coast Ramble. We're hanging out with some of your favorite artists. Comment in and be a part of it. It's West Coast Ramble every Saturday night, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It's West Coast Ramble.
We have Dr. Sheldon Abbott from The Cure for the Blues, and he is going to introduce the tribute to Little Walter.
Many people consider Little Walter to be the greatest blues harmonica player in history. His revolutionary approach to the harmonica earned him comparisons to seminal musicians like Django Reinhardt, Charlie Parker, and more recently, Hollywood Fats. His virtuosity and innovations altered many listeners' expectations of what was possible on blues harmonica. He was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2008, the first and to date the only artist to be inducted specifically as a harmonica player. He was raised in Louisiana, where he learned to play harmonica. He quit school at the age of 12, left rural Louisiana, and was busking on the streets of New Orleans, Memphis, and St. Louis. He honed his musical skills on harmonica and guitar, performing with older bluesmen like Sonny Boy Williamson II, Sonny Land Slim, Honey Boy Edwards, and others. Arriving in Chicago in 1945, Lil Walter occasionally found work as a guitarist, but garnered more attention for his highly developed harmonica playing. But being frustrated with having his harmonica drowned out by electric guitars, Lil Walter adopted a simple but little-used method. He cupped a small microphone in his hands along with his harmonica and plugged the mic into the public address system or a guitar amplifier. Little Walter pioneered pushing his amplifiers to explore and develop radical sonic effects previously unheard from a harmonica or any other instrument. Little Walter made his first releases in recordings in 1947, Chicago. They owe a strong stylistic debut to the pioneering blues harmonica player Sonny Boy Williamson. Little Walter joined Muddy Waters Band in 1948. By 1950, he was playing acoustic harmonica on Waters recordings for Chess Records. For years after his departure from Muddy's band in 1952, Chess continued to hire him to play on Muddy Waters recording sessions, and his harp is featured on most of Muddy Waters' classic recordings from the 1950s. Later, in 1952, he stepped out in front again when he recorded as a band leader for Checker Records. His first completed take of the first song he attempted at his debut session became his first number one hit, spending 8 weeks at the top of the Billboard R&B chart. The song was Juke, and it is still the only harmonica instrumental ever to be a number one hit on the Billboard R&B chart. Little Walter had 14 top 10 hits in the Billboard R&B charts between 1952 and 1958, including two number one hits, the second being My Babe in 1955.
My baby don't stand no cheating, my babe. Oh no, she don't stand no cheating, my babe. Oh no, she don't stand no cheating. She don't stand that midnight creeping, my babe.
A level of commercial success never achieved by Muddy Waters or his fellow Chess blues artists, Alan Wolfe and Sonny Boy Williamson II. Many of Walter's vocal numbers were written by him or Chess A&R man Willie Dixon, or adapted from earlier blues themes. In general, his sound was more modern and up-tempo than the popular Chicago blues of the day, with a jazzier conception and less rigid approach to contemporary blues. Little Walter recruited his own backing band, the Aces, a group already working steadily in Chicago backing Junior Wells. Little Walter also played harmonica on records by Jimmy Rogers, Johnny Shines, Floyd Jones, Bo Diddley, and even Shel Silverstein. Little Walter suffered from alcoholism and had a notoriously short temper, which in the late 50s led to violent scrapes with the law and irresponsible behavior. This soon led to a decline in his fame and fortunes. He toured Europe twice in 1964 and 1967, the 1967 tour as part of the American Folk Blues Festival resulted in the only known film footage of Little Walter performing. A few months after returning from his second European tour, Little Walter was involved in a fight while taking a break from a performance on the south side of Chicago. He sustained only minor injuries in this altercation, but they aggravated his previous encounters. He died in his sleep the following morning. Music journalist Bill Dahl described Little Walter as king of all post-war blues harpists, who took the humble mouth organ in dazzling amplified directions that were unimaginable prior to his ascendancy. His legacy has been enormous. He is widely credited by blues historians as the artist primarily responsible for establishing the standard musical vocabulary for modern blues and blues rock harmonica players. In his life, Little Walter directly influenced Junior Wells, James Cotton, George Harmonica Smith, and Kerry Bell. He includes Cherry Portnoy, Rick Estrin of the Little Charlie and the Nightcats, Kim Wilson, Rod Piazza, and William Clark among those who later studied his technique and later popularized it with younger players.
Next we have on the show, Bob Corritore. Bob's been called the curator of the blues. He started his career in Chicago, learned by many of the greats, and then eventually made his way to Phoenix, where he became owner of the seminal blues club, the Rhythm Room.
Me and Bob go way back, played together and been to his club, played his club many times, and played on records together many times with some great guys. And it's just an honor to have you here, my friend, and pleasure to have you join us on this program.
That's so cool to see you, kid. Man, the last time we got together, we had a blast. And, you know, I'm sure there's more of that in the future eventually when we get past all this pandemic crud. So I look forward to that day.
Yeah.
Get together once again.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too. Absolutely. One of the great things about Bob, not just his harmonica playing, and he's a great guy to hang out with, is he's like a curator of one of the only longest running blues clubs around, called the Rhythm Room in Phoenix, and it's been an institution. How many years you've been there, Bob?
28 years, kid.
Wow.
God.
That's a lot of years.
28 years, man. A lot of good memories there with a lot of people.
Indeed.
Several people that, you know.
Kid, didn't you do a Floyd Dixon show?
But, you know, we've had some good times.
But, yeah.
And, you know, the club has done some great things. The cool thing about that, kid calls me up and says, Bob, you know, we want to do this thing with Floyd Dixon. He's been diagnosed with cancer, and he doesn't have long. So how soon can we do this? So we came up with some dates, like, right away, and we just put it together. And we really all worked hard to make that thing happen. And Bob Auerbach, of course, did a great job. And, you know, we went in, and we made some history there. And, you know, Kid was the musical quarterback of that whole event. So, and thank you for thinking of me, Kid, to allow us to have the honor of that in our room. Appreciate that.
Oh, it was great. I thought it would be the perfect spot for it, and it was. And even though it was 107 degrees outside, it was nice and cool in the club. Man, it was like Zimbabwe outside, man, I'll tell you. And Bob, you know, you've been playing harp for years, and you came up in Chicago, and you got to play with a lot of these guys and see a lot of these guys like I did, and they're all gone, you know. You know, like Chico and all the people that you were a great, you know, curator of the music and almost a caretaker of a lot of those guys, you know, by giving them a place to play and making records and bringing them in to do records. And that's to your credit, man. You really helped keep those guys going.
Well, you know, the honor was all mine. They allowed me to be next to their greatness. And so, and every time that you got with one of those guys, the Henry Grays or the Pine Tops, you know, you got a lesson. You got a lesson in music. You got a lesson in life. And, you know, it makes me very humble to think that I actually got to hang around those people and participate in music with them, because to me, those were the heroes. And it's just funny because back then I'd get the attaboys, and now there's nobody to give me the attaboys. I'm giving the young guys the attaboys. It just doesn't feel right because I'm nowhere near the greatness of any of those old guys that gave me the lessons. But I do my best. So
what's the song you're going to do next, Bob?
I'm just going to do a little slow blues. It's got a hint of Big Walter Horton in here. It also has a whole bunch of Bob Corritore in here. So nobody left me Big Walter, but I did get to see him hundreds of times. And it was always a joy. He lived in his own universe with this tone that nobody else could ever touch. But I did get to hear that a lot, and some of it came, you know, some of it rubbed off on me a little bit. So I just love the way the guy played. He has a brilliant tone, fantastic phrasing. He was so musical. He was born to play harmonica. So let me, I can't really do him justice, so I'm just going to play a little blues and try and channel a little of what he did into what I do, if that's all right.
Sounds great.
Okay, well, it's here we go.
Yeah.
Job. Thank you.
Yeah, man.
I love that Big Walter thing. And again, I was around it so much that I know what it's supposed to sound like. Not that I can get exactly there, but I can hit some parts of it. So he just had a beautiful vibrato. Just he opened up his throat and all this gold came out. It was like a rainbow came out of his harmonica. It's gorgeous.
And so you picked out a video for us to watch?
You know what, John Primer and I, we have a new record out. It's called The Gypsy Woman Told Me. It's our third record. And it's out on the Vistone record label. And so we did a couple things just recently with him in Chicago and me in Phoenix. And we put it together, and I think it came out pretty good, and I hope you like it. So in this one, we're doing a Jimmy Reed song. And it's called Knocking on Your Door. And, you know, John's great voice and guitar style. John's, you know, I've known John since the 70s. I used to go to Teresa's to see Junior Wells when he just started working. And him and Sammy Longhorn were side by side playing guitars. Then I see him with Muddy Waters after he joined Muddy's band, Magic Swim and the Teardrops, James Cotton. John's just the real deal. And so at a point we started working together way after we had known each other for years. But we hadn't played together, and all of a sudden we started playing together. We're going, you know what? This fits pretty darn good. So we've ended up making three records in partnership, and we've toured and had a blast together, and I think there's more to come. So, you know, I hope you like this little snippet with John Primer and yours truly.
Hello, everyone. This is John Primer in Chicago and Bob Corritore in Phoenix. We could not do our CD release party at the Rhythm Room because of coronavirus. So we would like to do the song from a CD, a brand new CD we just got out, called Gypsy Woman Told Me, and I hope you will like it, okay? So you can also go online and buy it May the 1st, all right? So we're gonna do a track title, a song from this CD called Knocking at Your Door, which one of Bob Corritore's favorite tunes, and mine too, and everyone else. One of Jimmy Reed's old classic tune, you know. All right, okay.
Mm-hmm.
get it in. I'm knocking at your door, baby. I'm wondering why I can't get it in. I've been knocking at your door, baby, ever since I don't know when. Honey, don't you have no doubt. Well, I ain't gonna leave, baby. Honey, don't you have no doubt. If John Prime can't get in, ain't nobody walking out. Get in. I'm knocking on your door, baby. Honey, why I can't get in? I've been knocking on your door, baby, ever since I don't know when. Tell you got the blues, man. We got the Corona blues. COVID-19. Yeah. Do it again, Bob. That sounds good.
In the universe of stars in the blues harp world, very few have as big a reputation as our next guest, Rod Piazza. Here he is playing Lockdown Baby from his home in Riverside.
Yes, somebody fooling someone down the line. Somebody, people, fooling someone down the line. ain't seen it get this funky in my whole lifetime. I've been locked down, baby, 24/7. I've been locked down, baby, 24/7. Just me and Miss Honey, but that's almost like heaven. Wow. Scott, hey kid, just here to say hi to everybody, hoping everyone comes out and see Miss Honey, myself, and the whole Mighty Flyers at the PCH Club in December. All right.
So kid, when I was young and seeing bands around Southern California, it's always seemed like they were harmonica bands with like William Clark and who else were some of the great harmonica players from Southern California?
Well, I mean, of course you gotta think of James Harman and Rod and I mean those were the guys that were playing all the time, you know. There was a few other guys out there, but Johnny Dyer, Johnny would come and play and sit in.
Yeah.
And William Clark was the other one, you know. I'm trying to think of anybody else, you know.
You know, the thing that I always remember most about Rod was he kept the same band, it seemed like, more than other people. And they always put on such an amazing show with Miss Honey and Junior.
Yeah. Rod was like one of the first guys I met when I started going and, you know, seeing all these bands and stuff. Before I met James Harman, I met Rod.
Yeah.
Because I saw him at the Golden Bear again, of course. And I think they were opening for somebody. At that time, it was called the Flying Saucer Band.
Oh, yeah.
Rod Piazza and the Flying Saucer Band. Because that's the song Little Walter did, the Flying Saucer thing. So he had Watson playing with him, and Watson was playing that Espanada with the metal binding on the bottom.
Yeah.
And that just blew my mind, man. You know, I was into Stratocasters and 335s. I never seen anything like that in the tone that he got and the stuff he was playing, you know. And Willie Schwartz was drumming with him, and of course Bill Stubbe and Honey on the piano. And Rod was just always had, you know, they all looked good. They had the suits on. They had, you know, it was slick, man. And Rod was doing all those little Walter songs, you know. It was really great, man. Rod really had a great band, and he was, you know, top of his game, you know.
Here is a young Rod Piazza from 1968 playing at the Playboy House Party.
Thank you.
Wow, I didn't even recognize Rod in that video. That was fantastic. You know, these musicians really need your help in this time during the pandemic. They were some of the first ones out of business. With the clubs being closed and nobody on tour, they're probably going to end up being some of the last people to get back to work as well. So please give generously to the information that's coming up on our third show Patreon. And check out stellarshowsatjax.com. Thank you.
Yeah. play me the drum.
That's our show, Coronaville. We've explored the roots of the blues harp and all of its limbs and branches. I want to thank our hosts, Kid Ramos and Scott Abeyta, and also Jackie Sackheim for the gorgeous photos she's putting out in book form soon. We couldn't produce these fine shows without your support and your dollars. And by support, I mean share these shows with your friends and be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel, stellarJAX, so you don't miss an episode. stellarJAX, J-A-X. For dollars, just click on stellarJAX.com and high rollers are mentioned on every show. Stay tuned for the next episode of Eclectic American Roots, broadcasting live on Facebook. We archive all of our shows on YouTube at stellarJAX. Please go there and subscribe so you don't miss a show.